Hey friends, this video is about how I made the drum groove you can hear in the background. It's a new track that I'm working on, and let's dive right in and give it a listen. Okay, we will start with each individual track and then working our way through the whole drum setting. And I will mute the melody and harmony elements for now. And let's listen to the drum track soloed. Okay, first of all, I will start with the 909 kit. It's the basic 808 909 kit in Ableton. And I just exchanged the bass drum. In this case, I used a 808 sample that I found on my hard drive. And the first thing, if I solo this track for a second, which you notice is the 16th delay on the kick drum. This. So you may be asking yourself, how did he make it that he could send an individual sound contained in a drum rack to a send effect? Let me show you how to do this. First of all, you go on the whole channel, and then you wanna engage the option I/O, input/output, and the send button here, and then with right clicking you can create another return channel, a return chain. I did that with this one, and here you can tell Ableton where the signal should feed into, and I set the return channel E, which in this case is my dub delay, which the kick drum is feeding into. And then you can, then another send appears right here, and you can dial in your number that you like, or you can even automate that. Let me show you that. I drew in a automation modulation curve, and you also may know that you can unlink them. So your automation curve is moving freely in relation to your clip length. Sorry, and this adds another layer of dimension to your grooves, because even though your pattern repeats after several bars or maybe an uneven count, your modulation can be a different length, so it repeats in another fashion in relation to your pattern length. Okay, the next thing, apart from the kick, is the hi-hat. This is just a basic 909 hi-hat, And you can see here, I automated the release. Same fashion here. In this case, the modulation length or the length of your envelope is linked to the pattern length. But you also could unlink that and make this one longer if you like. Okay, so basically the hi-hat opens up over time. Really nice effect. Okay, next element. We've got some claps going on here. And those are all also just the basic 909 claps. And you can see that the clap length is also automated. To give it a little bit of randomization to it. Obviously, the hits and the automation line won't match to each other, but yeah, it just a little bit of randomness and variation is always nice to have. And then on this page, on the controls page, I automated the pitch. So over time you get varying pitches for your claps, which is also nice. And one idea that pops into my mind when I hear that is that you could pan them, each clap, in a direction, in an independent direction. For example, the first hard left and the second hard right or something. Or in this case, tuk tuk, left right, maybe. Okay, that's it for this 909 stuff. The next thing I like to... Oh, one interesting thing I did, I think, to the hi-hat. Ah, okay, not in this case. Okay, screwed, sorry. Next thing, toms and snare roll. Basically snare roll. I did not use the tom clip here. Okay, what does it sound like? Okay, there are some toms in it. Okay, I recorded them with my Ableton Push controller, and I think I did not quantize them. So yeah, I made sure that I played the right feeling and a little bit shuffle, and yeah, almost a marching style to it, a marching feeling to that snare roll. And the interesting part about the snare is, first of all, I compressed it, okay, nothing special, the DBX 160 on the snare preset. And this is the magic. It's the Tal Filter plugin, which is a plugin you can draw automation in and set specific time counters or time dividers. If you like to emulate ducking effects or yeah, introduce a shuffle feeling, I recommend the 16th count here. And it depends what your aim is. In this case, I wanted to automate or modulate the volume like a compressor would do. But you could also choose a high pass filter, for example, 24 dB per octave, or yeah, you can see it on your own. Or even automate the pain. The pen. okay, so I drew in a special curve, and it accentuates every sick second hit. And just play around with these curves. Maybe you want to go to this curve as a init preset or as a starting point, and then tweak it for your own use. I find this for hi-hats and yeah, snares very good fitting. And you can also play with the depth a little bit that it's not as hard hitting or hard affecting as you draw it in. But you could also do it in just lowering the amplitude of your automation or modulation here. Okay. One thing I like to notice, I like to point out, is that I delayed the whole signal of the snare roll 5 milliseconds ahead of time. And this is a technique that introduces a little bit of urgency, and you basically want to play with the delay values till the point that it feels right, and don't go by the values, just listen to it and hear what feels right to you. Okay, and one side note is that these values could potentially change over time when your CPU is going up. It could be the case that those should be readjusted. Let's move on to the hi-hat tracks I recorded with my TR-09 drum machine. And I already did some type of decay modulation on the closed and open hi-hats. And first of all, let's listen to that. And same thing with the delay here. Let's go to the processing. We've got NLS channel to give it a little bit of draw. Quite a bit of drive on the mic preset. Then we've got EQ8 rolling off the low frequencies. Then we've got API 550 on the hi-hat preset with a lot of snare. And then we've got this tile filter again with a slightly other curve drawn into it. And then again EQ8 for EQing the harsh frequencies out of the top end. And let's listen to this in comparison or in conjunction with the whole drum set, whole drum track. Let me mute the Tal filter modulation plugin. Okay, it basically shapes your hi-hats. Okay, let's move further. And if you wonder where is the pan knob, the pan pot going, you can access your split stereo pan mode if you right click on your panning knob. This is nice if you like to recover or have both sides of the signal. With the usual init setting of your pan knob, if you pan hard left, your right signal will be faded out. So you will lose all the information in the right signal. If you do that in split stereo pan, in stereo pan mode, you could potentially, if you want to pan hard right, get the left signal and pan it to the right side. So you basically add the left and the right signal of your source to the right side. So you won't lose your left side for that. Very nice to know. Okay. The next thing is the ride, and the ride comes out of the 707 kit, also the basic 808, basic Ableton drum kit. Okay, and once more. Tal filter, you noticed it introduces a nice bouncing feel to the ride, and I also delayed that to 11 milliseconds ahead of the rest of the signal or the rest of the timing grid. Let's give it a listen, especially the Tal filter. I will mute that when we listen to the whole drum mix. Okay, nice. It gives a nice shuffle feeling to it. Really worth checking out this plugin. And in this use case for the ride, I chose low pass or high cut setting 6 dB per octave. And I reduced the depth quite a bit. Okay, next thing we've got the percussion kit. Just the factory Ableton percussion kit. First of all, we've got congas. I detuned them quite a bit, minus 10 semitones. And the bongo is +4, +3. And also on the whole drum group, there is Tal filter. It isn't just on the individual tracks. It's on the whole group. And I think that Oxford EQ, yeah, it's rolling off some of the high frequencies. We will come to that later if we hear the shakers. Okay, this is the case now. We've got the Kabasa shaker, and I rolled off the high end quite a bit because it sounded harsh to me. Okay, the second shaker, this X shaker, same thing going on here, rolled off the high frequencies and the low frequencies as well. And yeah, let's give it a listen. Especially with those shakers, so that you can hear the difference that Tal filter makes. Okay, it's engaged now, and I'll mute it. Huge difference, right? Too static for my ears. And now it's breathing and moving and grooving. Okay, and also I delayed that 17 milliseconds ahead. Okay, all of these percussion and drum elements are feeding with send A into the drum group. You noticed I've got the channel set to sense only. That we are creating a drum group here. And I made three chains to that drum group. I'll go to them each individually. The main group contains NLS bus. I'll disable them for a second, that we can hear the difference that it makes. Oops, it's better to okay, I'll disable my group processing in whole so that we can hear the difference. Okay. Again, huge difference. How did I do that? First of all, NLS bus, added a little bit of drive on the spike preset, And then I introduced Edge EQ, another great Waves plugin, and I use that one in mid-side mode. On the side signal, I'm rolling off the low frequencies and enhancing a little bit on, what is this, 3.15k to 0.75 decibels. And on the mid signal, I rolled off the top end a little bit at 18k. Or is it? No. Okay. Yeah, at 18k. And I dipped 117 hertz or 2.5 decibels. This makes a huge difference. Check it out. Sorry, now you can hear it. We just listened to the mono signal. Without. It's like magic. Be sure to check this out. Mid-side EQ, it's awesome. It opens your stereo field and it does some kind of phase shifting to your frequencies, and it's really powerful. Okay, next thing is compression, bus compression. We've got several instances of API. Two instances. And yeah, it's a very conservative gain reduction going on here, just half a decibel. And then we've got our drum room. Sounds like this, all the way up to wet. And it was on 20%. Okay, another instance of API compressor, bus compressor, and once more just a gentle gain reduction going on. Then we go into the Fairchild compressor 670, and I also use that one in mid-side mode, which is marked as LAT and VAR in the settings, and I boosted the right channel, which equals to the side channel, quite a lot, 2.6 decibels. And let's check it out. I think it tightens up the low end and glues it a little bit more together. Okay, second chain for the drum processing, drum bus, is parallel distortion. The idea of parallel distortion is quite similar to parallel compression. You feed a heavily edited or heavily compressed or distorted signal into your dry signal, which is in my case the main chain. And the distortion sounds soloed, sounds like this. First of all, I'm rolling off low end and getting rid of 367 hertz. And then my main distortion plugin is Camel Crusher, which is very awesome. It's a free plugin, check that out. It's so suitable for bass distortion and even dubstep wobbling basses. It's very nice. And on this track, I used it on Dark Crunch preset and gone a little bit further in tweaking. And let's check out the difference. Yeah. okay, this Oxford EQ isn't doing anything. Yeah, I'll mix that with the original unprocessed signal to a degree of minus 12 dB. And I'll mute that parallel distortion for a second that you hear the difference. Okay, it adds a lot of loudness onto it, which isn't that nice if you think of unity gain, that your processing shouldn't increase the overall loudness of your signal. But for this time, or for this case, I can deal with that. Focus your attention to the emotional factor that is going on, or the emotional impact if I mute that, or if I reintroduce the parallel distortion. Okay, for me it sounds like it's boring, and then I turn it on and it's from 1 second to another it adds more dynamic depth and emotion, and that's what I like to have when I'm producing in the box. Oftentimes it's super clean and super digital, and I like a little bit dirt in it and irregularities, if that's a correct word. Yeah, same thing with parallel compression. Another bit of intensity what's going further if I reintroduce the parallel compression. Okay, how did I do it? Compressor on almost limiting setting infinite to 1. Then exactly the same instance once more. Then I added drum bass and changed the init setting to hard. And I don't know if compressor here is on initial setting, but anyways, and then I rolled off the low end to 138 Hz. Okay. The last remaining thing is the delay channel. The delay channel for the kick. I like to add to that I delayed the signal also, just to the degree that it feels right. In this case, it's 11 milliseconds delayed after the time grid. Let's solo the kick. Yes, it's set to 16th notes, and like I said before in another video, it's very much the resonance that makes the emotional difference between the delayed and the undelayed signal. If I move the resonance to 0, you will feel that the emotional impact is gone. You also hear that the delayed signal is a little bit modulated by this parameters, and I even offset the values for the left and right channel slightly, so that it opens the stereo image even a little bit further. And of course, because I'm sending the kick to the delay track, I will get rid of or I like to get rid of the low frequency information and just delay the upper parts of your kick signal. And of course, because it's a return effect, it's set to 100% dry so that I can blend it in with the original signal. And then last step is the compressor set to sidechain mode, which is receiving a ghost kick that is playing here. It's just set up and I never, almost never touch that. The audio is going to sense only and the sends aren't even enabled. So it just gives the trigger signal for sidechain compression. And sometimes it can be nice to use your actual kick, because if you are going into a break where the kick is disabled, then your sounds breathe a little bit more. But there are also use cases where you like to keep that compression and ducking effect going even in breaks. Then you do it like I did here with your ghost kick that just runs for infinity, or that just runs infinite. Okay. Let's listen to the end result one more time. These shakers, yeah, you hear it. They greatly contribute to the shuffle feeling of the overall track, and mainly because of the delay here and the TAL filter here. Very robotic, static, but I also have to mention, that comes in my mind when I hear that, I played them in with Ableton Push, and there's a setting which you can turn on. It's called repeat, and you can set the division how often it's repeated in one bar. And I chose the 16th setting, and there's also a knob for shuffle, for swing, and I think I dialed that to the value 38. So it's adding a little bit of shuffle also to that. I don't know if there is an option to introduce that kind of shuffle you would get if you use Ableton Push later. I right now only know about this one method to dial it in when you use the repeat to dial it in. Yeah. Okay, but another option I will cover in another video is the groove pool quantization. But yeah, that's another video, and one more time, the track idea. Okay guys, that's it for now. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. And if you want to get announced if I post new content, hit the subscribe button. And if you've got questions on that video or like me to do several things that I did not cover in this video, let me know it in the comments. Thanks.